I'm Sharon Bill. Welcome to my YouTube channel. If you're trying to choose a performance repertoire list, whether it's for an exam, say the ABRSM performance exam that's remotely assessed, or also the Trinity College do the same as well, you need to be thinking of how to organise your programme, or even if it's just deciding to give a little bit of a performance for your friends, having a bit of an evening soiree, even if that's digital these days. You don't want to just provide a dull, repetitious kind of sequence of musical pieces. It's rather like choosing a menu. So there's a difference between if you're going to sit at the kitchen table and just have your sandwich for lunch and a mug of tea, or if you're going to entertain and provide a nice evening meal for your friends and set out the table nicely. Whenever I'm sort of entertaining, I always do a lily serviette just to create a nice little table piece. You want to create a special mood, don't you? And when you're creating a menu, you don't want potatoes, 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 bland, bland, bland. Neither do you want, say for example, if you have a hot spicy main, you probably wouldn't follow with spicy ginger cake afterwards. You need to cleanse the palate and have a nice refreshing sorbet or something like that. And it's exactly the same when you're choosing a musical performance programme. And so you need to think about the rise and fall, the ebb and flow of how the music's going to follow on one from another. And so you may want to start with a bang and have a really arresting opening piece and then just calm the mood down with a nice lyrical, gentle, romantic piece. And then you may want to go out with a bang. Or also you could think, well, I'll have a nice, jolly, bright start, but then the programme's going to sort of calm down gradually. We might have a splash in the middle and then end on a poignant finish, kind of a meditative finish. And so there's no absolute prescription of you must start fast, you must end with a firework display, or you must start slow and gradually build up. You've got to listen to the way the pieces flow into each other and create a nice varied menu or palette of dishes that will create refreshing change and provide a diverse programme for the listener. Also, if it's for an exam, you need to show your skill in playing lots of different pieces. One good sort of rule of thumb, I think, is to make sure that you've got a nice little representation of most of the musical periods, or as much as you can fit in. So you might start with a nice Baroque piece and then follow with a lyrical romantic piece. Then you might finish with a really wacky 20th century piece. So you could perhaps, for example, begin with one of the programmes that I've been sort of figuring out is begin with a nice Bach prelude or a gigue or something like that, a nice jolly opening, nice and busy, and then you could follow with, it's kind of a similar mood, but you've gone into the classical period then, you might have a little bit of a sonata, which in itself would perhaps have a slow movement, or you could then have a romantic piece with lots of nice lyrical melody line moving between the clefs and a bit of pedal work if you're playing piano, and then finish with a really fruity 20th century piece, very modern, very avant-garde, ending with a bit of a quizzical sort of comment at the end, as it were. Or you could think, well, I'm going to start with a nice gentle piece and then we'll have a really robust, bouncy Mozart sonata, and then we'll finish with a nice lyrical folk song or something like that. But do think of it in terms of a menu. And so make sure that you are demonstrating lots of different techniques. So for a Baroque piece, for example, say if it was a flute repertoire and you are playing a Baroque Telemann flute sonata, you will be demonstrating most likely lots of different tonguing techniques. You may, if you're doing a fast piece, may even be demonstrating double tonguing, triple tonguing. If you're playing on the piano a Baroque piece, chances are you're demonstrating the rigidity of your touch and your finger control and so on. If you're playing a romantic piece, you're demonstrating your ability to convey a searing melodic line. And so on the piano, you're showing that you can bring out the touch of the melody and really bring out the cantabile, whether it's in the treble or the bass, and all of the accompanying sort of surrounding notes are of less importance than bringing out that lyrical melody line. Or if it's a classical piece, you're perhaps demonstrating your agility in playing fast Alberti bass lines, or the dance-like character of the piece and so on. And then if you're playing a 20th century piece, I've said this before, I think I mentioned it in my Off the Wall vlog some time ago. In my experience, if you play a 20th century piece, it may not be the sort of thing you would choose to listen to, although you do get into it and it becomes sort of a strange, haunting beauty to some of these pieces. But you are demonstrating a willingness to jump in and embrace something completely outside of the norm. And my experience shows me that examiners really like you to do that. And you're demonstrating your ability to take on really new musical techniques and get into the challenge of this very challenging work that isn't absolutely melody. Some of these 20th century pieces, for example, a Messiaen piece I'm going to try and have a go at, it's very percussive. And I think that's quite appropriate for the piano, which, if you bear in mind, that's a percussion instrument. And so the piano takes on a sort of an Indian gamelan kind of sound. And I do remember playing a John Cage piece years and years ago that was for prepared piano, and that really did turn the piano into a percussive instrument. And it completely changes everything you might think about playing the piano. And it was really good to just embrace that and have a go. And so if you finished on something like that, that'd be like ending on a really cordon bleu dessert that's got some abstract art chocolate piece that's doused in, I don't know, bourbon or Jack Daniels or something really hot and sort of spirit, so, you know, really spirited finish kind of thing. And so when you're choosing your programme, do think of it as you're preparing a musical meal to be listened to, whether it's for your friends or for an examiner. It doesn't matter, you're still giving a musical performance, and after all, music is for performance. You're not just learning music, really. Yes, of course, you're learning for your own pleasure, but music should be heard. And so let's just get it out there and provide a series of dishes to bring delight. And whilst we're on the topic of performances, let's just think about the performance itself once you've chosen your programme. And I know that I'm repeating myself here, but it's really, really important to create a sense of occasion and create that performance atmosphere, even if it is that you're performing to a camera, if not an actual audience. And so the first thing I would think, if you could, is to engage with your audience. And this might seem strange if you're just playing to a camera, but once you've done all of your introductory blurb, as it were, do try and at least just give a little eye contact and smile at the camera, and then carry on with your performance. Don't break the mood between the pieces. And then if you can, at the end, when everything's finished, just maybe just a smile at the camera before you go and switch off the recording. I don't mean in a cheesy, as the last chord is playing, you give a cheesy smile to the camera, you know, good night, God bless, and drive safely home. You know, that, not that, no. However, if you can just give a polite smile to engage to the camera. I do remember being taken to, not a rock concert, it was kind of a hippie concert of sort of kind of trancey keyboard music. I don't know why I went. It must have been my sister had a spare ticket and took me. And I remember, now it may be that I wasn't sufficiently into the music to have been overawed by the band and their stage presence. But I remember that they came onto stage, didn't look at the audience, didn't look at the crowd, didn't say anything, did their thing, and then just walked off again. Now, that may have been their stage persona of being cool or whatever, but I remember thinking it was really rude, and I really felt like, yes, I am a spectator. I didn't feel part of the performance at all, and it just felt really remote and impersonal. And I think you do need to just engage a little, perhaps at the beginning, at the end. However, you must make sure that there's, I've said this before, I know, you must frame off each piece. Let the music die away, pop your hands on your lap, no fidgeting, and just sort of let the moment settle before you then go on to start your next piece. Because otherwise it would be like at a meal having the dishes cleared away whilst you're still eating. You know, if you're having a meal, you put your knife and fork on the plate and then finish so that the waiter knows to take away your dishes. You know, they don't kind of whip the plate from under your nose as you're still chewing, do they? And so that same sense of occasion needs to occur as you're doing your performance. So just let the music settle. Don't break the mood between each piece. So don't start turning your pages and rattling on to the next course, as it were. But let there be time to digest before you go on. Let the palate cleanse before you go on to the next dish, as it were. And so just a thought about making sure, once you've chosen your programme as well, then think, how am I going to project this performance as well? So whether it's to, even if it's just like to a group of chums, I know I said to my pupils in the past, if you have to pay your siblings to sit and listen to you, do so. If it's a row of teddy bears, just perform to something. I remember hearing of an actor who practiced his performance by talking to a brass doorknob to learn to communicate to a camera and to an audience. And that is so true. And so whether you're performing, you know, pay your friends in, or your great aunt in tea and cake to sit and listen to you, or when you're recording, imagine who will be listening and create a sense of occasion. And again, just finishing off with the mealtime analogy, it's the difference between sitting at the kitchen table with a sandwich and a mug of tea, as in just knocking out a bit of a tune, or creating a sense of occasion, setting the table, giving a sense of occasion for each course, having a moment, engaging with your guests, and creating a real atmosphere of an occasion. I do hope that's helpful to you. Thanks for listening. Bye.